You're not going back the same. You will have an encounter with Jesus. Your life will never be the same again. The Lord is up to something great in your life, and you will never be the same again. Your life will never, 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 never be the same again. Oh, glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. If you believe it, give Jesus a loud clap. Oh, glory to Jesus. Take your Bibles. Let's get into the Word. The book of John, chapter 13. A couple of weeks ago, I began talking about love. It's the only thing that distinguishes us from any other group of people in the world. When we walk in love. In fact, the Bible says God is love.
Amen.
Amen. I got one amen, and that is also good.
Amen.
Amen. Love is the only thing that distinguishes us from all other people. Love is not talk. It's easy to say, I love you. But love is an action word.
Amen.
And so when you say, I love you, you have to back it up with your actions. Your actions must confirm what you just said to me. And that is what makes it love. Hallelujah. The book of John chapter 13, let's look at verse number 36. Look at what the Bible says. And Simon Peter said unto him, Lord, whither goest thou? Jesus answered him, whither I go, thou canst not follow me now, but thou shalt follow me afterwards. Now, this statement by Jesus is a reflection of where he expects us to go after he took off. He said, where I'm going, you cannot go now. He uses the word now. It's the same expression when they came to him and said, how come we couldn't heal that child? And he said, this one going by fasting and prayer. Remember when Jesus was around, his disciples never fasted. That is why the disciples of John the Baptist came around and said, how come we fast? They don't fast. How come we wash our hands before we eat? They don't eat. And Jesus said, well, it's not what goes in, it's what comes out that you got to pay attention to. So Jesus had a unique way of approaching issues. Now, whilst Jesus was here, he was the one fasting. He said, you're going to be fasting when the groom is taken away. In that same way, he's telling the disciples what was to happen after he is gone. He said, for now, look at verse 36 again. He says, whither I go, thou cannot follow me now. It means it was only appointed unto Jesus alone to go through the things he went through, to die on the cross. Nobody else could do that.
Amen.
That is why nobody can play Jesus and nobody can pretend to be a savior.
Amen.
There is only one savior.
Amen.
Nobody can be a savior.
Yes.
There is only one savior.
Hallelujah.
He didn't say, I'm one of the saviors. He says, I am the way.
Amen. Amen.
He didn't say, I am one of the truth. He says, I am the truth.
Amen.
He didn't say, some people can get you to the Father. He said, no, it is only through me. No one cometh to the Father except by me.
Amen.
He knew who he was. He knew his assignment. He knew what God made him to be.
Amen.
To create the way. Earlier on this morning, we were talking about we making ourselves into a bridge that connects the world back to God.
Wow.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And Jesus is our perfect bridge. He connects the world to God. And Bible says in this scripture that Jesus was about to go somewhere that we could not go. So don't allow any human being to be a savior in your life.
Amen.
Because human beings cannot save. There is only one savior. His name is what?
Jesus
Christ.
Amen. Amen.
And if you don't have that savior, you haven't actually begun this journey. And if you are in this room this morning, you haven't given your life to Jesus, it is about time you do so.
Amen.
You know, earlier on this afternoon, I met a Muslim man from India, and I was telling him, myself and Dimitri were trying to present the gospel of Jesus to him. And then we told him Jesus. He said, no, his name is Isa. I said, well, that is the translation of Jesus in Arabic.
Amen.
And I asked him, do you know Jesus died for you? He said, no, he didn't die. Some people tried to kill him. And God came around and took him away. I said, no. Jesus died, but what you are saying about God taking him away, it didn't happen. But that was after he died and he resurrected, he got caught up into the heavens. And then he says, we also know that he's coming back. I said, I'm glad you know he's coming back, but are you ready when he comes back?
Amen, amen, amen.
And that caught his attention.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I tell you, there are so many people out there who haven't heard anything or have any understanding of who Jesus is. And God has prepared us as a church to bring the gospel to the world.
Amen.
So we cannot sit down and see the world perishing.
Amen.
I said earlier, on any church that doesn't evangelize, that doesn't reach out and bring the gospel of Jesus, is a dead church.
Mm-hmm.
It's a dead church. In that same way, any Christian who doesn't preach the gospel of Jesus, it's a dead Christian.
Amen.
Amen. Have mercy.
Yes. Any Christian who doesn't preach the gospel, you're a dead Christian. You're only a Christian when you enter into the church room. Once you step out, anything that looks like Christianity has to be hidden. Because you don't want anybody to know you have anything to do with Christ. But I love what Jesus said. He said, anybody that publicly declares who I am, I will speak about him openly to my Father.
Amen.
Do you know that anytime you make a request to God, Bible says Jesus sits on the right hand of God. And you know what he does? He sits on the right hand of God interceding for us. Yeah. What that simply means is that anything you ask God, and that is a principle in the scriptures, you ask God in the name of who?
Jesus.
It means anything we ask God, Jesus turns to Jesus on the right hand and asks him, what do you think about this request? And Jesus is like, he's been denying me all year. So this request, bam, denied. He says, when you deny me before men, I would also deny you before the Father. So some of us don't even realize that the key to unlocking our own breakthrough is preaching the gospel of Jesus.
Amen.
Sometimes we think we are doing people favor, but as a matter of fact, we are doing ourselves favor. There are things we are wrestling with. Some of you are desiring for healing, but that which unlocks your healing is your desire to present Jesus to this lost world. He said, as you speak about me, I will continually speak about you to the Father. But I want to be the one that speaks about Jesus the most. I don't know about you.
Amen, amen, amen.
But how can we forsake such a great love that Jesus has shared for the whole world? How can we? The Bible says, by this shall all men know you to be my disciples. By what? By love. When you love one another. But the fact is, like I said earlier on, love is not just talk. It's an action.
Amen.
You can come to church all day and say, I love Jesus. But when you step outside, your whole life is a reflection of, I hate Jesus. I don't want to have anything to do with Jesus. Anytime you come to church, you will cry when songs are sung. You will kneel down. You will fall down prostrate and worship him. Make everybody in church believe you love Jesus. But the moment you step out, you deny him blunt. You don't want to have anything to do with him. In fact, your family members don't even know you come to church because you sneak to come to church. When did the church become an underground activity? Your friends won't even believe if they ever saw you in this church's website or Facebook and they saw you sitting in church. Some of them will pass out. He goes to church.
My God.
Seriously. Because of the very life you exhibit in the workplace. There is nothing Christ-like about you in work, at work. I spoke about duality. When did I teach about duality? Recently, right? 2 weeks ago. Having double personality.
Yes.
You're a Christian at church, you're an unbeliever in the world. When Bible says you are the light that must bring light to the world. And then we get into the world and we compromise. Bible says we are in this world, but we are not of this world.
Yes.
How could a fish be in water? I mean, when we went to the retreat, Pastor Chris was teaching me how to swim. And some of you were laughing. You think it's an easy thing. Some of you came around and said, Apostle, now you now learning how to swim? This guy was busy trying to get me to float. And then anytime he leaves me, I just go, yo. I go right down there. And I said, this thing is not easy. God forgive you if you ever laughed at me. You think it's an easy thing to float in water?
It is.
I'm telling you, it's not an easy thing. And I saw these little ones who were swimming like fishes. I said, what is happening?
My God.
Yeah. But Bible says we are in this world, but not of this world. Have you ever seen a fish drowning in water before? Yeah. It lives in the water, but it knows how to overcome the water. We understand the law of gravity, right? That anything that goes up must come down. We know the law of flotation. But all these objects are able to float. Some of you are able to float, right? William, do you float?
Yes.
My God.
Floating is not an easy thing. To break the law of flotation. But the thing is, I'm not giving up.
Amen.
I'm ready for my second swimming lesson. Yeah. Amen. Oh, yeah, we're doing it. We're doing it. Hallelujah. Now, the book of Galatians, chapter 5, verse 22 and 23, talks about the fact that love is a fruit. Love is what?
A fruit.
You know, when your love emanates out of the flesh, that is when today you love, tomorrow you hate. But when your love emanates out of the Spirit of God, and now I'm talking about God's kind of love, that is why people believe that the love of God is ridiculous. How could you die for somebody who has not even been born? How could Jesus die on a cross for somebody who has never heard about his name, yet his death has already provided salvation way ahead, even before the person gets to ever hear the name Jesus? How could somebody's death on the cross suddenly wipe away all my sins, and before God, I'm suddenly like a new creation, without spot, without blemish, like somebody that has never sinned before? How is that possible? People actually say that the love of Christ or the grace of God is scandalous, because it doesn't make sense to the natural mind. Amen. But look at what Galatians 5 verse 22 and 23 says. Bible says, but the fruit of the Spirit is what?
Love.
What is the fruit of the Spirit?
Love.
What is the fruit of the Spirit?
Love.
Now, what that simply means is that anything that is a fruit can grow. Fruit grows.
Amen.
It means that the love of God within us can grow. So we might all not be at the same level when it comes to the love of God, because some have taken the time to grow.
Amen.
In love.
Amen.
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 Some have taken the time to do what?
To grow in love.
And that is the love that emanates out of the Spirit of God. Now, in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 13, which is going to be the core of our teaching for the next couple of weeks, today I'm just giving a little introduction to it. Bible talks about what love, talking about the love of God, which comes as a fruit of the Spirit, what it is and what it is not. 1 Corinthians 13. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
So a few more people don't have it. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
If you don't have it, say, Lord, help me. Now, if you don't have it, just give up and listen. From verse 1, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not charity or love, I am become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not love, I am nothing. Did you see that?
Mm-hmm.
Look at number three. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have no love, the profit is zero.
Amen.
Number four, love suffereth long and is kind. Love envieth not. Love vaunteth not itself. It is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. Number seven, beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Love never fails. Love never fails.
Amen.
The love of God never fails. The love of God never fails.
Amen.
Whether there be prophecies, the Bible says they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. But love never fails. Glory to Jesus. Bible says the love of Christ never fails. It means it never ends.
Amen. Amen.
The love of Christ. Now, I want to share with you briefly what love is and specifically tell you about the fact that love is patient.
Amen.
Tell somebody love is patient.
Love is patient.
Now, if you love me, you're going to be patient with me. If you love me, you're going to endure with me, because that is one of the things love is supposed to do, endure at all things. Now, enduring all things doesn't mean that I'm enduring your attitude in this marriage, but I'm going to let the whole world know, because love is also kind. I hate your attitude, but I know through your attitude, God is training me to be patient. You see, patient is not something sitting in a gallon in heaven. You pray to God, give me patience, and God takes out of that gallon and pour patience into your life. When you pray and tell God to give you patience, you know what he does? He brings some ugly people in your life, provoke you, tempt you, make you angry, until patience becomes matured in you.
Amen.
You don't go on your knees and pray, God, fill me with patience, and the next moment you walk around and suddenly you have patient immunity.
Mm-hmm.
Anger immunity, provoking immunity. Suddenly people are ugly to you and your emotions are shut off. Can you imagine if there was provocation immunity? People who do CNA would have been the first to take it. Now that takes you a while to absorb it. I had a friend that used to take care of an elderly person, CNA, and this guy had memory issues. So this guy loves donuts. Anytime this guy gets in there, the guy says, hey, you stole my donuts. And the guy hates donuts. The guy doesn't even like donuts. And this man, he will buy a dozen of donuts, he will eat three, it's left with nine. He came and said, hey, my donut was 11, what happened to two of them? And this guy used to get so upset. Meanwhile, this guy was a powerful child of God. And sometimes this guy will come so angry. He said sometimes the guy will pick up a chair and slam it, who ate my donut? And he was trying to tell me what he did one day. He said, one day the guy took the chair, slammed it, who ate my donut? And he also took one chair, slammed it, I didn't eat your donut. One of the most painful things you could ever go through is when people could look you in the eyes and tell you you've done something that you know truly you never did. If there was an immunity to shut off your emotions to such situations, I bet you there'll be tons of people that want to shut themselves off. There are people that wish they could shut themselves off by some kind of immunization against anger in marriage. But that is how we grow in patience.
Amen, amen, amen,
amen.
The more you pray for patience, the more God sends terrible people into your life. The more you pray for patience, the more your spouse provokes you. And you're like, man, see that? I think you've been demonized. No, you are the cause of it. You've been praying for patience. But how do we embrace that? Because Bible says that love is patient. If you truly love me, you're going to be patient with me till I mature.
Amen.
Till I grow up. We all have some growing up to do in an aspect of our lives. There is nobody here. In fact, Paul says that if you ever got to a place of thinking that you've arrived, he says, take heed. Because our final arrival point is in heaven. And until you get there, you haven't arrived anywhere.
That's the truth.
We've been in church for 20 years. And suddenly somebody walks through the door and we want them to instantly to be matured in their way of thinking, their attitude, their behavior, their conduct, just like us. But it took you 20 years to get to where you are. And if you truly love that brother that gave his life to Christ today, you will walk him down the aisle. Hold his hands. Study the word with him. Love is patient.
Amen.
It's patient. Another word for patient is long suffering. Long suffering. So if you love me, you must be ready to suffer with me for a long time. And in the midst of it, guess what? The Bible says love is kind. And sometimes we are like, you know what, he's so nasty, this guy. I don't know why I married him. And you're like, so what are you doing about? You know, Bible says we shouldn't, you know, we should endure. So I'm just enduring, but he's such a stupid, you know. You're not being kind. You're enduring, but you're not being kind. Love is enduring, and it's also what? Kind.
Amen.
So you cannot be enduring and destroying the man at the same time. It means your love is not complete. Your love is complete when your love is totally sold out.
Hallelujah.
You know what? I think there is a lesson God wants me to learn in this relationship, and I'm going to take all the time in the world to get it right.
Amen, amen, amen.
Some people break out of relationship hoping the next one will be better. Because the first one had an attitude, only to realize that the second one, although it was glittering, it wasn't really gold. And you see, when it comes to relationship, I always see it as, I compare it to the onion. You know, the onions has layers. You take layers after layers and you discover all kinds of layers. And for the most part, when you are dating, the only thing you see is the outer layer. You only see the outer layer. And sometimes, onion layers might look very nice, dry outside. You cut through and the middle is green. Brown, nasty, stinky, rotten. Right or wrong? If you don't cut it, you don't see it. And so you see this beautiful, gorgeous, Holy Ghost, supposedly filled sister who does the Holy Ghost dance in church more than anybody else. Comes to church and her walking is so sanctimonious and pious. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And then you, sister, to you are so crazy about this brother because this brother this brother is Holy Ghost filled, man. That's the brother I want to marry. Forgetting that rent is not paid by tongues. They are paid by check. Yeah. And now here you are stuck with this guy. And this guy doesn't like to work. He does 15 hours a week and says, I'm done. I'm called into the part-time ministry. Glory to Jesus. Is somebody receiving the word of the Lord?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Oh, I love Jesus. I love Jesus. Tell somebody, love is never complete.
Love is never complete.
Until it is total.
Until it is total.
Enduring me, tell somebody, enduring me.
Enduring me.
It's not full love.
It's not full love.
Your love is complete.
Your love is complete.
When you do all that the Bible instructs you to do.
All the Bible instructs you
to do. Amen. You see, it's so easy to tell somebody I love you, but are you backing that love? How do you love me when you see me dying and you don't care about me? What kind of love is it? Is it just talk or is it an action? Some of us are doing well with the enduring and with the long suffering, but we are not kind. It's a place we all gotta grow. Hallelujah. Love suffereth long. Love endures all things. Love is kind. Are you kind in your words? Ask somebody, are you kind in your words? If you are not kind, you are not loving. Yes. Are you enduring? There are some of us, we are so short-fused. A little thing, you explode. And I tell you what, we are a work in progress. Because I understand that people you love the most are the ones that can really get you to be explosive. The ones you love the most, they are the ones that could really touch your very sensitive and last nerve. They could get it. They could get it. That is why this love cannot be done out of the natural. It is out of the Spirit of God. It is a fruit of the Spirit. Amen. This love emanates out of the Holy Spirit. You cannot love the way Jesus loves or God loves if you don't allow Him to be the source of that love. Because there are certain people in your love, in your life that are just unlovable. There is nothing about them that can activate any love in you. In fact, there are some of them, although you're a Christian, you wish they were no more. But you see, it is that love. You know, in some churches, if somebody is caught in witchcraft, they will kick that person out of the church. You know that? If somebody is caught in witchcraft, they will kick the person out of church. There are some churches, if you are caught in fornication or adultery, you know what they will do to you? You will not do anything in church. They will give you a big chair at the back. You will sit there for 1 year till you get yourself together, and then you are recognized again. And anytime you sit on that chair, everybody in church knows what you did. Yeah. So after service, everybody will pass and look at that brother. He never closes his zip. His zip is always open. He has problems. But the Bible says those of us who think we are better, we should restore those that are weak. The Bible didn't say we should tear them further down. There are churches, if you were demonized, they will kick you out of the church because you've contracted demons. But you see, love will teach you something different. And let Jesus be your model. Jesus never kicked anybody out. He kicked the devil out of their lives and kept them. That is what Jesus does. He kicked the demons out of them and kept them. I did a whole teaching on the cave of Adullam. If you look at the kind of people David brought together in that cave and began to train them, disabled people, people with mental problems, people that had all kinds of challenges, those were the first generals David brought in the cave of Adullam and began to train them. They were the people David used to take back the kingdom. So sometimes God will cause you to have certain people in your life, and you are so short-sighted, you are looking at their current circumstances. You are not able to see with the eyes of God what their future looks like and what God could potentially do with their life, and so you limit them. That is the reason so many people are not able to find people even in a church to marry. They say there are no men in the church because they are seeing the men as of today. They cannot see them as of tomorrow. So they are going about in the world looking at men who are in their tomorrow. Yet there are men in the church. Tell them, Lord, you heard that, a lot. And I'm talking about good men. Good men. And there are good ladies too in the church. And Sunday, there are good ladies in the church. I'm telling you, there are good ladies. Good ladies in the church. Yeah. There are good ladies. Good ladies in the church, I'm telling you. You know, when you shared your marriage to your wife with me, I was blown away. I was blown away. You know why? In fact, when we're coming home this morning, I was talking about it. That I believe you married your wife because of her gifts. They just had a wedding. Listen to this. His wife passed away about 3 years ago. He remarried. How many months has it been?
It's been June 23rd.
June 23rd. He knows the date. That's a man that will bring you a gift on the anniversary. He didn't say 3 months ago. He said June 25th. You have to look for men that remember your birthday. And your anniversary. Hallelujah. Do you know what amazed me? And he was so proud to say, he said, Pastor, do you know I'm 62? My wife is 70 years. So who said a 70-year-old cannot be married? You should see the wife. You saw the wife yesterday at rehearsal. Does she look 70?
No.
I thought she was like 50 years.
Yes.
Yesterday, you should have seen her doing rehearsal, dancing, and you know, I said, wow.
Yeah.
So you are just 24 and you're already frustrated. Hey! 24. I can't find a husband. 24. 17 years I'm getting married. Say I'll get married if you are not married. Please, if you are married, don't say that. You can't marry again. Say, I will marry if I'm not married. Emily, you're sitting by your husband and saying, well, I will marry. Hey! 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 Yeah, you have to pray for your wife. She says, I will marry. Hallelujah. Listen, church, I want to leave you with one way. Bible says, by this shall men know you.
Amen.
As my disciples, when you love one another. God wants you to be your brother and your sister's keeper.
Amen.
It's not enough to meet a brother in church and say, hey brother, God bless you. Let's have a powerful service. How was your week? And God wants you to step out of your comfort zone. You've been talking to the same people at church for the last 1 year. There are sisters and brothers that come to church every week. You've never spoken to them. And you claim you belong to a kingdom, a family of Christ. And the only people you know is the sister that always sit by you. Walk to somebody and say, brother, how are things with you?
That's right.
Brother, what work do you do?
Right.
Where do you live? Oh, brother, you know, they're hiring in my office. You know anybody that is looking for a job? I'm talking about practical love. Somebody in this church, you see, the preaching alone is not enough. That is what the Bible says, that forsake not the gathering of yourselves together.
That's right.
And when we gather, and I thank God for this church, recently I went preaching in the church. By the time I finished the benediction and I walked to the back, everybody in the church was vanished. We went with Marilyn, you were there. Marilyn is like, what is going on here? We just closed and everybody is gone. Love Legacy, when we close, that is when church begins. Because we believe that church is not complete without fellowship.
Amen.
Fellowship. How could you be my fellow in a ship and not know what I'm going through? Fellowship. A fellow in the same ship.
Yes.
And you don't know what I'm going through because you don't care about me. And then you stand there, I love. What kind of love it is? When my rent is past 3 months due and nobody in church knows about it. And I claim I belong to a family. I've not been working for 6 months. And anytime the church leaders call me, they are first thing, why are you not paying your tithe? And 3 months I've not been working. I would want somebody to call me and say, sister, you know what? Is there anything going on in your life we could help you with? God made us to be givers before receivers. He said, when you give, you receive. He didn't say, when you receive, you give. No. Giving must be done by faith. And we belong to a kingdom of faith. So your starting point is giving, not receiving. And your giving of love must not just be talk. Give of yourself. Sometimes that which you have to give is your time. Sometimes all somebody needs is a hug and some comforting words.
Amen.
You see a brother that always comes to church laughing, smiling, and all happy and giggling, and suddenly he comes and he's like, he doesn't want to have anything to do with anything in church. And you are like, this brother, I think he's contracted some demons. We have to pray for him. Look at him, the past 3 weeks when he comes to church, look at his attitude. But you don't know what he's going through. Why don't you draw closer to that brother and find out, is there something going on in your life I could be of help? You see, I realize that true love is appreciated in the days of our challenges.
Amen. Amen.
And sometimes God allows those challenges to come to test the hearts of people that claim to love us.
Amen.
And sometimes when those challenges come, that is where you really get to distinguish those that truly love you and those that don't love you. Listen, in my life, I've gone through so many phases in my life, and I thank God for every single one of them, because through those circumstances, God was able to distinguish those that truly loved me and those that pretended to love me. You see, in this kingdom, I always say that it's only in this kingdom that, because of lack of understanding, you are killed for getting wounded. Now, when you get wounded, you are a disgrace to us, so we have to kill you and bury you so that nobody gets to know you were wounded. Only in this kingdom. So if you were one of us and you were caught fornicating, we have to kick you out of the church before anybody begins to say one of our members is fornicating. Only in this kingdom. If you were caught stealing and you are arrested, we have to quickly deny you as one of us so that nobody will think that this church is full of thieves. That's what Christians do. Anytime you get in trouble, they don't want to have anything to do with you. But who were the people Jesus hung out with? And he didn't just hang out with them. He loved them. He went to their homes. He ate with them. He fellowshiped with them to the degree that they said, this guy cannot be of God. He's always having time with robbers, tax collectors, all kinds of people. That was how he was accused. Why do we do that? Because we are busy building reputation for ourselves. We want to look so cute and so clean. God doesn't care about your reputation. He cares about your character. And that's who you truly are, your character, not your reputation. Reputation is just people's perception about who you are, and you act it all day. Some of you should be giving Grammy Awards because you are good actors. Good actors. You act characters. You're actually characters. Characters. You know. Let's stand up. We need to walk in real love. I said we need to walk in what? Real love. Real love. Not pretentious love. Listen, this morning you might be here, you heard the word of God, you have never given your life to Jesus, you have never opened up and said, Lord, come into my life. Be the Lord over my life. What a great place to make that decision. Knowing that after this decision, if I was to die or Jesus was to come, I'm going right to heaven with him. Hallelujah. Today, that is your decision. You have a great opportunity to do so. You want to surrender and give Jesus an opportunity in your life? Wherever you are, I want to pray with you. You might also be born again, but life and the journey with Jesus has not been the way it's supposed to be, and you feel led to rededicate your life. I will pray for you. If today your decision is to live for Christ, I want you to lift up your right hand, and I want to pray with you. Thank you so much. I see your hands. You want to give your life to Jesus. God bless you, Mom. Keep the hands up. Keep the hands up. I want to pray with you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Jesus is going to come right into your life, and life will never be the same. It's going to be a great journey with the Lord. You know, sometimes people say, I want to stop certain things going on in my life before I give my life to Christ. No, you can't. You can't. He loves you the way you are. And as you come to him, he makes sure that your life doesn't remain the same. You can't stop the things going on in your life. You need him to help you stop those things. So I'm glad you're giving him the chance. Please come forward. Thank you so much. Please come forward. Help her come forward. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. This is what happens when you go into the community and preach about Jesus. People walk into the service and give their life to Christ. Thank you so much for coming. We love you. Amen. Amen. Who brought her to church? Brother Alex. Come on, give God some praise. And Sister Jordan. Amen. Who invited our sister to? Sister Whitney. You see, you can be taking pictures and preaching the gospel at the same time. Oh, glory to Jesus. Let's all lift up our hands to Jesus. Please lift your hands. And I want you to make this confession unto the Lord. Say, Lord Jesus, I thank you today. You died on the cross for me to pay for all my sins so that I can be restored unto God. Lord, I believe that you are the Son of God who came to die for my sins. My good was not enough to pay for my sins. But I know and believe today that your blood is powerful enough to wash all my sins. And I thank you that your blood has washed all my sins today. I thank you because I'm restored back to you. I know and I believe anytime you choose for me to come home, my name is in the Lamb Book of Life. And so I will come home. And even if you were to come today, Lord, I know you would take me with you home. And for this, I bless you. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. God bless you, my sisters. Welcome to the kingdom of Jesus. Please lift your hands with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your word unto us today. Lord, we pray today that the spirit of love that emanates out of the Holy Spirit will be activated. That, Lord, we will no longer sit around speaking of love, but we will live love. Amen. Lord, let marriages in this room be restored. Amen. With true love. Amen. Let relationship, family relationship, friendship relationships be restored with love. Lord, cause patience to mature in us. Lord, cause us to walk in long suffering and still be kind. Lord, cause us to become your very image, for you declared that through this will men indeed know that we are your disciples when we love one another. Let your love never cease amongst us. Let your love never fail amongst us. Lord, cause us to walk in that perfect love. For we understand and know that perfect love casts away all form of fear. Let that love be established amongst us. In the mighty name of Jesus. And all shall say, Amen.